everybody. It's Lynn from WisconsinGarden.com, and this is part two of our mid-July garden tour. And you may wonder, what is this? Honeysuckle comes in many varieties, and this is one of them. When the blossoms are done, you end up with this round leaf with what used to be the blossom. And lots of different insects like to get in there and enjoy whatever is still on there.
Well, this is pretty well done for the season.
So this honeysuckle is this variety.
Can sort of grow ghost?
Mm-hmm. Huh. And it's different from the other variety that we have. But look at what's doing very well. Rick's favorite bush, the Daphne bush that we thought we had lost. It's flourishing, I must say.
Well, I did take off some of the dead cuttings and I did try propagating it. So
right.
We'll see what happens.
Yes. Yep.
I did get to the quince, but I never did get to remove all the old cuttings.
We've been so
busy and it's been so hot.
We have.
Yeah. My goodness.
Then, if you look this way, we have another
dahlia.
Thank you. I could think of as Daphne. And over here was where our Peruvian daffodils were.
Those were spectacular.
Blossomed and they were wonderful. And now, well, I gave my sister one and she sent me a picture and she said, "Am I killing it?" And I said, "No, it's just done." She said, "It's turning brown." And I said, "It's like a tulip. You know, they have to go through their cycle, and once they bloom and you cut off the stem, all the energy will now go back into the roots, and then eventually they will just get brown and kind of flop over."
But you did tell her they have to be dug up because they are tender bulbs, right?
She's aware of that.
Okay.
Yes. Our first dahlia to blossom is spectacular.
Well, I tell you, I really have grown to appreciate dahlias.
And while this might have helped me when I put it in here.
What'd you do? Just use tape?
I just did tape because I was in a rush.
Minnie, I have a machine that creates these labels for you.
We had some labels and
you lost
them. They're around somewhere.
Probably with that clock you lost.
This is a weed. And I keep pulling it out and it keeps coming back. But I had one little canna left, and I thought, oh well, I'll put it in there with the, those are zinnias, some more zinnias, and I had a bunch of seeds. This is from you, Scott. This is your coxcomb that you sent me seeds last year and I never got to plant them, and they are now beginning to flower, so thank you. Now, leading hearts, absolutely gorgeous in the spring. And then they get like this. And
they're 3 foot tall.
And then they get like this. So what I do is I just chop them off because look, they're bending over anyway. They're pretty much done. Even if you cut all the greenery off, the roots are there and they will come back. So don't worry. The
look what's blossoming.
The hostas. Blossoming. Absolutely beautiful.
Are these fragrant?
No.
No?
They're not.
Not like the one in the back.
No. This is a Miss Kim lilac bush that Rick has trimmed back like we always like to. And when you go over to this side, I am showing you what it looks like once you take all of that bleeding heart out. Because this was also full of bleeding hearts. I stopped right there, as you can tell.
And you can see what the sun has done.
Yep. But, again, you can take that off because there are new leaves under there that are waiting to show up.
They'll take the place.
So I'll just chop them off when they get too crispy. These are alliums that are absolutely spectacular as well. Each little head will have a seed in it. So if you leave it in a place and just let it drop its seeds, next year you will have more.
Let it go, let it go.
And they come in different sizes, just so you know. This is the one that stays closer
to the
ground.
I think this is a Globemaster.
This is a biggie. Yeah. So.
And then how about your yarrow?
A couple years back, I found a yarrow that promised that it would not get wild and take over. And so this yellow one is gorgeous. And it will stay like this for the majority of the season.
Kind of reminds me of Queen Anne's lace that you see
it
out in the fields.
It sort of does, yes. And then you look down here and you think, oh no, she killed something. These are daffodils. They're done now. I could take them up and just put them in the mulch pile, or you can leave it down as mulch.
Well, you used to braid them when you had a little more time.
Yes. I don't do that anymore.
No. And our giant hibiscus will be coming out shortly.
Oh my gosh. But this is another place where this was my area of attack for yesterday. But instead of getting here, I ended up doing thistles.
Oh, and look what's here.
Yeah, they're back.
The Japanese beetles have returned.
Yep. You need to get your little machine out here.
Yes.
Suck them up.
I know. I actually bought a vacuum cleaner, a little hand vacuum cleaner that I'm going to experiment with this season.
Yes, he did.
I have to get out here.
Liatris that had seeded itself.
And, of course, the Japanese fernleaf peony is done.
Yep, in amongst all these other weeds. So this one eventually will start turning brown, and then it'll look like, ooh, what is that? But it has to go through its cycle.
Remember those four giant white hibiscus plants we had out in the front? This is where they came from.
This is the mother plant.
This is the mother plant. This will get to be taller than the pergola. And again, giant size blossoms every single day.
They are.
They'll have a cluster.
Yep. Everywhere you look, there'll be blossoms ready and waiting. This is a cranberry
crush, or jazzberry jam.
This is one of my favorites. That's a pinkish with red. And then there's this one. That
Midnight Marvel.
Midnight Marvel that has dark, dark red blossoms.
And look what's still blossoming. The Clematis.
Yes. And that blue one is another variety.
And a lot of hosta leaves that are crispy.
Is that a blossom up on that kiwi vine? See the red? What is that?
No.
No? Okay.
I don't see any red.
Oh, I do.
You do? Well,
uh-huh.
let's go up here.
The kiwi vine was supposed to give us grape-sized kiwis. About this big. That's what it was. Who knows? We haven't seen that before.
No. Well, plus you didn't have to cut back any of the woody stock this year.
Well, I did cut a little bit.
This is the new growth.
This is all new. Now, this is questionable because it is a zone 6.
Also, I want you to take this little wire netting off once.
This is our solitary bee house.
And if you look, every place that is packed with mud is from a mason bee.
Right.
But I didn't see any leafcutter bees this year. Any activity?
We haven't.
Not at all. That's most unusual.
Yes, and kind of frightening.
Oh.
That we haven't seen them, because they should have started taking over by mid-June.
Yep.
Let me get this back in here to keep the birds from going in there and building a nest. Let's look at this other one to see if we can find any of the leaf cutter bee. So if there were leaf cutter bee activity, you would see a green at the end of the tube.
And all of these seem to be mud.
It's a mud. Yeah, which indicates the mason bees.
Yeah.
But on the other side, because there's nothing in this one. They don't seem to like that one at all.
Oh yes, there's one right there. There's two.
Oh, yes. See how different they are? There and there and there.
Another one over here.
Here they go.
And there's a couple over here. Oh, that's encouraging.
Yes. Huh. Very much so.
Yeah.
Fantastic.
And again, they're solitary bees. They're not hive bees. Bees.
Right.
And I've been, in fact, there's one that's going in right now.
Yeah, two of them.
But you can be so close to them and they don't bother you at all. And if you were to get stung, it's like a mosquito bite. I think this one likes being on camera. And they're not big.
No.
But it's amazing. They can cut a perfect circle in
2 seconds. It takes 2 seconds for them to cut a circle in your rose leaf and then fly back and puts 26 circles between each egg.
So they put the pollen in first, lay the egg,
right,
and then pack it.
26 circles.
Somebody actually sat there and counting 26 as a typical average packing.
Yes.
Boy, somebody had too much time on their hands, I think.
Help! Help! The wisteria is getting me. Look at this thing. It's gone crazy. This had absolutely gorgeous blossoms if you hadn't seen one of our other garden tours, and now here it's going to seed. These are the seed pods. These will drop down eventually if I don't cut them off and start new wisteria plants.
It's now, just loaded.
I don't know how many wisteria plants a person would want, but
never enough.
They are amazing, for sure.
Well, this is part of our home security program, too, because, you know, people aren't sure, should I walk through this or shouldn't I?
Will it go in or will it capture me? South side. This is the dill that Rick loves to have growing everywhere.
I can't get enough of it.
I mean, I can. I can't get enough of this.
Well, see, you get your, and one is starting to,
I know,
to actually bloom here.
Yep.
I like the way it starts at the top and works its way down.
Yes, it does. And all of these will do that. So it's something that just appeals to me.
Now, you have white and purple, right?
Yes.
Do you have yellow?
No. I don't know that there is a yellow.
Oh.
But then we look in here, more liatris, an old-fashioned thistle compared to Canadian. That is called smartweed. It has
How smart is it?
Well, it's smart enough to keep going in my garden, even though I keep trying to get rid of it. Another hibiscus. This is a short one.
That's a Luna Pink.
Yep. Very pretty. This is yarrow. Well-behaved yarrow. This is a pink variety.
And again, we also have large hibiscus
in the back.
Up and down. But look at the size of those iris leaves. I mean, those iris leaves are almost, if I took a yardstick, they're close to being 36 inches long.
Yeah, those are bearded iris, purple, mostly purple.
I've never seen iris leaves that big, though.
No, and we never do anything with those either. I mean, I cut them back. I mean, I cut the head off of them, but I never cut them back. And they are in rich, rich soil. And the rhizome is not even on top of the ground like it should be.
And is this some more?
Yes, it is.
Lovely.
Yeah, it is. Morning glory. And it's trying to hide my hibiscus plant. So I will be out here cutting off these garlics and also pulling down the morning glory.
Well, I'm sorry I had to pull you away from this job yesterday to get to that, to help me lay all that plastic to get rid of the thistles.
Something has to be done. It has to be done in a timely manner. Here is another
native.
This is a native coneflower, echinacea.
Yep.
These are
Asian
Stelladora.
Lily? Or Stelladora.
Stelladora lilies. This is a lily that This is an Asian lily that got chewed off by the deer, so it's trying again, and I keep putting milorganite right on top of it.
I think milorganite along with plant skid, are the two, probably mill organite is still the best for deterring deer, rabbits,
yes.
and
yes,
they don't like the smell.
You can put it right on it and on the plant. And I mean, plant skid is great, but it is smelly and it does discolor the plant for a while.
Well, it's iron.
Yeah, where mill organite doesn't really bother anything. That was a
poppy.
Oriental poppy.
What are you going to do with the heads of these?
Well, last year I took them off and I was going to spray paint them and make them into decoration. Yeah, but I never got to that.
No.
Now here is another.
Echinacea?
Echinacea, but this, you can see that the petals do not go backwards. They stay up. It's a double. So this is not a native. It likes to be a native though. It comes back every year. This is another kind of yarrow, and I'm not quite sure what it's going to look like when it gets bigger, but it'll be very pretty.
And there's one of your little Japanese friendly peony babies.
Yep, in amongst this
wood sorrel.
Wood sorrel.
Another nemesis, especially for those who've been watching. In fact, you can see the mill organite that you have on this leaf right here. See
yep.
that?
Mm-hmm, yep.
And there's some more down in the lower leaf.
And if they can smell it, they'll stay away. These are baby liatris coming up here.
Hmm.
Oh, darn. Coreopsis.
And more little iris.
Allium. These are dwarf iris. Hmm. Yep. And now this is where I had planted several more peonies that we bought, the roots. And for whatever reason, they are not coming up yet, but I did dig up one of the roots just to look at it, and it looked perfectly fine. So it might be one that has to
go through the season
and then come back in the spring. This is, what am I pointing to? Yucca is back there, the tall, pointy stuff. The stalks you see are
fig
stalks. I don't think our season is good for fig.
Oh, it's not long enough.
Where the plant itself comes back, but we don't get any figs. And this is our Korean maple, which is doing very nicely, I must say, and is loving the rain.
I think there is some trimming that needs to be done this fall, though.
Mm-hmm. I'm sure there is. So. Yes, you don't want them winking up like a...
Oh, look what else you have.
And this is one of my Mexican sunflowers that...
Grew from seed.
Grew from seed, but in the house. But you can see how beautiful they are. I mean, it's almost neon bright, yes. And then I'll just cut that one back and more will come up.
Now that first year we had them, I think we must have planted all the seeds together because that was a humongous bush.
I think we bought a plant.
Oh, a plant?
Mm-hmm.
Okay.
And then it came up and was
That was amazing.
Then here's your mullein.
I see you have it contained.
Plant in a container.
This reminded me so much of our trip out west, you know, in Las Vegas and so forth when we were visiting my mom. I always saw these plants, and when I saw the mullein growing here, I thought, oh, how cool was that?
Now, this is a medicinal plant that had many uses in the past, a lot for lower respiratory things.
I think you need some right now.
But
the leaves are so soft. They remind me of
lamb's ear.
Lamb's ear, yeah.
Yes, they do. And it's a biennial. So the first year you're only going to get like a group of
leaves.
And the second year it sends up the stalk with the plant, with the flower.
And for those who haven't been seeing our amazing successful cuttings.
These are Montauk daisies. And again, they're in the chrysanthemum family. They bloom one of the very, very last flowers to bloom in the fall.
Now, mind you, we trimmed all of these back this spring
right here.
That area right there.
Right there.
And all of these have popped up since. All of these will have blossom heads on. And again, we could cut those right now.
We could. Now, each one of these will have a blossom.
Yeah.
So this whole thing will have blossoms.
It'll be one of the last blooming plants we have in our garden.
Yes.
Well, I think everybody saw our vegetable garden in our last video.
Yes. Then we see, you know, the lilies are getting toward the end. Again, I took Mill Organite and I sprinkled it around the whole thing just so that they would stay, because this would be an area that they could walk through.
And again, all of that back there is Montauk daisies from cuttings, and each of those containers, they too need cutting. But we won't do that until after they blossom.
Correct.
In fact, well, we probably won't do them until next spring.
Right. We'll give them the whole winter to rest.
And I see a couple other of your lilies survived.
Yes. And those pretty. The colors are beautiful. Yeah. And then these are liatris that have a home waiting for them. So they're just waiting for me to get there.
Now, I noticed you didn't have a whole lot of coleus this year.
Oh, well, I've got some in a bucket over there. I took cuttings from my coleus. They did very nicely, and I had a variety. I had at least two different kinds, this one and the red one. And toward the end of the spring, I noticed that I was getting mealy bugs on them. Hmm. And can't have that. All right, this is another kind of allium. Again, this one seeds itself. I don't put those in anymore. And this is a
Stargazer
trumpet lily. Very, very fragrant. Some people can't stand the fragrance because it is so overpowering. But they are amazing.
This was a poisonous plant that we thought we had killed trampling when we were rebuilding our water feature.
We didn't want to kill it, but we thought, because we had to do so much walking and working around there. This is a monk's hood, but it's coming along nicely. It might be a little shorter this year. And then there are the cannas that we planted in the containers. And if you got close enough, you could see around the very outside rim, I planted some nasturtium seeds. These little tiny round leaves there. This is mammoth mum. This mum could get 5 feet wide. When I planted it last year, it was about this tall, and it was one piece. And we put it in after we finished the water feature, and it has taken off. I'm very pleased with it.
And you had gladiolas that haven't blossomed yet that are in that container.
Right. Well, those, I don't know exactly what those are. They're in the gladiola family. They're supposed to be fragrant gladiolas. Here's some more cone flowers. I think these are double pink again.
And this was a red Japanese, this was a different color though than the other one.
Yes.
Japanese friendly thing.
Yes, this is a double. It's a double red.
That's what it was.
Yes, and then this is another hibiscus. And behind that, at the end of its growing cycle, was a red poppy.
And again, thank you, Brian, for that very nice gift surprise that you left us, this glass, handmade glass.
Ooh, there's the fish. You can see them.
Oh.
Hello, fish.
They have grown.
Yes, they have. They were probably, a third that big?
Oh, yeah. So, is it Friday fish fry yet?
No.
Oh.
No, and your lily pads are looking much better.
Yep. Well, I fertilized them. I got a special fertilizer for them.
Yep.
And the same inside. See, there was definitely something that was really attacking them.
Right.
But now, since I fertilized last week, I'd say the lily pads are starting to look pretty good.
And the fish are in here, so they can help eat any insects that might be the ones. We've heard something about a water flea that likes to eat those. But there's your little herd of goldfish. Having a good old time.
Well, we couldn't find goldfish this year, remember?
No, we had trouble again. But our lady at Myers, her name is Kim, who knows everything about fish, said, you don't want the baby feeder goldfish that we have. She said, they'll die on you right away. So you had asked her, what's another fish we could put in? And she said, I have a little bit bigger and much stronger goldfish, so why, you know, you might want to try those. So we did, and we're very happy with them. They seem to be working nicely.
Well, normally we buy them by the gross, 144 of them. We put about 100 of them up here and about maybe 40-some in the other little pond. But we have the activator pumps now, which help keep the mosquito population down.
True.
So that was our goal, was to have fish that would eat the mosquito larvae.
Yes. And these, the six that we have are doing very nicely.
Yep. They were expensive.
They were.
But worth it.
That's why we only got six.
Yep. Remember when we used to get koi?
Oh, dear.
And we'd come out in the morning and find a new koi fish head on the ground?
Once.
Yeah. That was a nice gourmet treat for the raccoons.
We learned our lesson.
Boy, $25 a meal.
Well, here we are in our backyard. It's a small backyard. It's short, but it's very peaceful. And in the afternoon, it's shaded by tall trees. So you'll see that the yarrow is still over there. We can see the water feature.
More allium.
Mm-hmm.
Why does that not surprise me?
Balloon flowers, chrysanthemums, lantana is the purple that you see. Ground cover that I'm forever pulling out because it gets everywhere. Our original pond is doing very nicely here in the shade. We don't get much algae that grows in here because it is in the shade, but we have an agitator pump here that keeps it very clear. And it's very calming.
Burbling.
Yes. And there are just flowers everywhere. I love it. If you enjoyed our mid-July garden tour, please give us a thumbs up. We'd appreciate that. Thank you so much for all your comments and your questions and your tips. And if you'd like to see more of our videos, you can go to wisconsingarden.com and see us over the years.
You know, it's funny. I think viewers know more about us than we remember about us.
This is true.
Somebody will find a video back from 10 years ago and say, remember when you planted this? Or what was that plant that at 7 minutes and 32 seconds, and you have to go back and watch the video yourself. Oh.
But see, that's what I'm talking about. All of the wonderful people that watch our videos. It's very, very heartwarming to know that people are watching our video and that they enjoy them. If you are not part of our garden family, would like to be, there is a subscribe button over here, and you can just click that, and then you can go up to the bell.
Ding dong, ding dong.
That bell will notify you when a new video is produced and uploaded. Have a nice weekend. Stay safe. Stay cool if you're in a hot place, and
healthy,
dry if you're in a wet.
Healthy, happy, and prosperous.
Yes. Keep the love growing. Bye for now.
So you're just going to sit out here for the rest of the afternoon,
yeah.
Huh?
Maybe I'll have another Sprecher.
How many Sprite? I have to order it by the case.
Well,
now.
I only had half of one.
Well, I know. I had to limit only half of one myself. I shared mine with you.
Yes, you did. Thank you.
You're welcome.
Connect with us on YouTube.